Hello. If I can have you take your seats, please. Thank you. Bonjour et tout le monde. Hello and welcome to the Rugby Canada Fiscal 2016 Annual General Meeting. My name is Miles Spencer, Chief Operating Officer of Rugby Canada, and I'm pleased to welcome all of you here in Toronto at the Marriott Toronto Eaton Centre for what will be another great weekend. A special welcome to those watching on Facebook Live. This is the first instance of Rugby Canada broadcasting this portion of the AGM to the broader community, so we welcome all the viewers across the country watching this afternoon. Today marks the start of another busy weekend focused on the interests of rugby in Canada. As you will see by our agenda, we have a lot to cover, and we are looking forward to the collaborative discussions that will take place over the next 2.5 to 3 days. It is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker, but before I do, let's take a few minutes to reflect on why we are all here. So to start this afternoon, we implemented, I think for the first time as well, a State of the Union address, which will be kicked off by our chairman, Tim Powers, and followed by Alan Vansen. So it's my pleasure to welcome our chairman, Tim Powers.
Thanks, Miles. I think it's important to clarify for the online audience that you haven't turned on to Netflix, and that wasn't Mike from Suits. That was Miles Spencer, our COO. So thank you, Miles. Although that may drive up Suits watching, so that's good. Thank you for all for being here and committing your time and efforts to rugby. Like thousands of other Canadians, you all give countless hours for the love of the game. You may not know it, but it's really, really, really appreciated. And thank you to all of you who are watching and listening online. We appreciate your interest, your passion, and dedication to the game here in Canada. Without question, we have much work to do. And as we work and plan for a better tomorrow for rugby here in Canada, we want to make sure we're more open, available, transparent with our vested Canadian rugby community, and for that matter, the world rugby community. I also want to say hello to our past president and current CEO, Pat Alvis. Pat is recovering in Vancouver from a recent health ailment. He can't join us here in Toronto, but we know he's tuning in at home, so there's at least one viewer. Pat, as we all know, he's a force of good nature, and he works tirelessly for rugby. We all who had board meetings this morning got a note from Pat expressing his disappointment about not being here. Know you're on our mind, Pat, and know you're missed. We all want you to get well soon. Can I get a big round of applause for Pat? I saw this on the plane yesterday, so I had to use it. I was watching a video about the current state of American politics, and they were interviewing Barack Obama, and they showed a plaque on his desk. And he had a sign on his desk that said this, "Hard things are hard." And here I thought he was the President of the United States. I didn't realize he served as a rugby administrator in Canada, but clearly that was the inspiration for the plaque. You know, if we're going to do a number of things and compete in a number of areas, we will never get them all right. We will try, but it's just not possible. But in the process of trying, we need to be honest about our success and failures, while respecting people's commitment to their undertakings. This is an important point for me, and something that's really been front and center over the last number of weeks, just prior to Vancouver Sevens in particular. I've found that there's been a lot of finger pointing. I have found that there's been a lot of unfair personal criticism, and that's something I want to speak about now. We need to govern the sport off the field the way we all played on it, working together as one, as a team. Not unlike in a game where mistakes get made, good teammates pull together. They don't point fingers, and they work to solve problems, not create new ones. You win as a team, you lose as a team. No one likes losing, and no one plans or sets out to lose. Mistakes are made, tactics might be wrong, execution might be off, but in the match or in the boardroom, you have to rally around and make do for the time being until time and place dictates the necessary changes that can be done to put you in a better position the next time. Slagging and undermining of people, enough of it. We're better than that. When family members read social media and see their loved ones demeaned, and they properly get upset and put off, that's not acceptable to me. Shouldn't be acceptable to any of us. We have a better culture than that. This is not the American presidential election, and we shouldn't have the same tone. So please, particularly those of you who may be watching, criticism is fair, it is good, and it's legitimate. Don't make it personal. Don't demean people. It's not acceptable. You won't see me doing it. I hope you don't as well. Rugby is a sport we all love, and it's known not only to attract good people and cultivate them both on and off the pitch. I totally get why we are all unhappy, as I am, about our men's 15 ARC outing. There's legitimate public concern about our recent performances. That said, we are seeing positive things elsewhere in the Rugby Canada business. They are included, but not limited to, our women's sevens team ongoing success. First Olympic medalist for the Americas everywhere. Bronze medalist, pretty damn good. Our men's sevens team improvement. Our women's 15s team continued high level of performance and a legitimate contender to win the Women's Rugby World Cup in Ireland this summer. Canada's Sevens tournament, growing and growing in popularity, 60,000 to 75,000, all good things. The Al Sharon, who is here with us, National Training Center, opening late this fall. Rookie Rugby's continued growth, and for the first time here today, UConn Rugby. Mike Fancy. Mike, how about standing up there? Canada a business, deliberately. While we in name are a national sports organization, in reality, we are a complex sports entity involved in the management and operations of numerous men's and women's teams in various age categories. We run events, we own facilities, we develop programs, promotional activities, labor relations, professional league development, franchise negotiation, you name it. Being a business means dealing with realities and making informed, smart choices. It means not being clouded by romantic interpretations of what we think once was, but rather embracing what is and doing the best we can now, cleverly, creatively, and importantly with all of our partners here and owners, collaboratively for the betterment of the game in Canada. It's also about evaluation, accountability, and honesty. Do we get it right every time? No, of course not. Are we prepared to say no as often as we say yes? I have had lots and lots and lots, and I want more, constructive conversations with passionate rugby people across the country. There are lots of good ideas, but we can't do them all. We all together must continue to try to make the best choices we can, but also not be afraid to say no, and develop the discipline to focus on doing better in key areas, not a few hundred key areas. Listen, everyone is entitled, of course, to their opinions. But if we don't act on your suggestion or your ideas, please don't stop putting them forth. But also, please don't align yourselves against us. We need to be working together like a team does on the field. Alan will talk about some of the choices we are making and what we are doing. We have a well-developed strategic plan articulated and supported at last year's AGM. We score ourselves constantly based on what we all agreed, all of us, what we set out, and how we are actually doing. And we are prepared to adjust and amend if that is necessary. We will make tough decisions. We have done that before. We will do that again. But we will look to avoid knee-jerk reactions because we're pissed off about the results on a particular day. I firmly believe everyone here and lots of supporters elsewhere wake up thinking about the good they can do for rugby, not the bad. We all need to keep collaborating and get even better at collaborating for the benefit of rugby in Canada. This is an important weekend for rugby for all of us. That is why we are all here. We want forthright dialogue and comprehensive, honest debate. We want to keep going forward as one. We want to push boundaries, and please do it. We can't be afraid, and this is a theme you will hear a lot this weekend, of uncomfortable truths. You're going to hear that phrase a lot. In fact, we need to deal with them head on. Remember that when we hear them this weekend. I know everyone here will give their all this weekend, and as we go forward and beyond, we may have a bit of fun as well, including those of you who are going up to the Alan Doyle concert tonight. Don't get thrown out or sully my good name, please. That is rugby. That is what we love, not sullying my name, although if you read the online post, it's often sullying my name. That's a joke. You can laugh. It's okay, really. You're allowed. Rugby people normally laugh. You all look so uptight. But before turning over to Alan, there are four people whose terms are about to be completed on Rugby Canada, and I'd like to acknowledge them now and ask them to stand when I call their names so you can give them a big round of applause for all the time, sacrifice, dedication, and hard work over the last number of years they have made for the game. They are, in alphabetical order, and sorry guys and gals, I want you to all stand, Don Daphne, Mark Lawson, Don Lawson, stand up, Troy Myers, and Gordon Smith. If you have a chance to say a personal thank you to them over the weekend, please do. I know for a fact it is deserved. None of them expect it, but please do say thank you. Thank you for listening. It's now my turn to do the same, and I look forward to speaking to all of you over the next couple of days. Now I'm going to ask Alan to come forward and share his thoughts. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Hello, everyone. Great to have you here. And don't get caught up with stage fright. It's only Facebook. We can be engaged and do some shout-outs and challenge. So as Tim said, and as our video alluded to, 2016 was an absolutely huge year for rugby in Canada. We've had many great successes, things we should be incredibly proud of. Our Rio Olympic medal by our women's sevens team, centralizing a group for our men's 15s in last August, adding a new men's 15s head coach in Mark Anscombe, bringing in a new men's sevens head coach in Damian McGraw. Our NTC, our National Training Center, breaking ground and naming it the Al Sharon Rugby Canada National Training Center, eliminating women's pay-to-play for our women's 15s players, launching our Play Smart program, our rookie rugby program, launching an inaugural Canada Sevens men's tournament, and launching our 2016-20 strategic plan. Those are pretty phenomenal things to do in a quadrennial, let alone in 1 year. So I'll grab a compliment to all of you. It was a big year indeed, and in and amongst all that, you've welcomed me very warmly into the Rugby Canada family. And as I've learned a lot about rugby in the last 12, now almost 13 months tomorrow, it's gone by like about 12 weeks. So I just want to say thanks to everybody for your warm welcome. But that's really where our pleasantries kind of need to end this weekend. We should be very proud of what we've accomplished in 2016. And it gives us a great foundation of which to build on for 2017. And we should take a moment, as we just did, in terms of really being proud of what we've done. But we can't tell ourselves that everything is good. We can't be that classic Canadian approach where, you know, we're doing really good here, really good here, and not really, as Tim said, confront the uncomfortable truths of what we face. In many aspects, as I said, they are good. However, we have much work to do. We have hard work to do ahead of us. Harder work than we've had to do in the past. Let's be frank, our pathway system is broken. Doesn't work. We're not producing the depth and talent that we need to keep pace with the rest of the world and what we need to do for our national teams. It's always important to bring outside perspective. I listed our two new men's head coaches who've joined the organization. Incredible experience, and they bring some great perspective on rugby in Canada. They both arrived at our COE and have met many of you and have traveled in certain instances so far. Around the country and have met much of our rugby players and system. And they commented how great our structures are, how great our national training facilities are, but their same question back to Jim Dixon has been, where are our players? Where are the people that are going to field our national teams? We're not seeing it. We've got some phenomenal talent out there, but we're not seeing it. So this being particularly the case for our men's game, it's not necessarily the case today for our women's game, but we can't trick ourselves in believing that what we're doing as a system for our women's game is going to be good enough moving forward. We've got to address our men's and women's game with the same vigor as we move forward. We've been the beneficiaries of early adopters in women's sport, as Canadian sport has been in many other sports, but the rest of the world is catching up. They're going to start doing things that will challenge us for our positive women's rankings. So we have to find a way to implement a stronger system. Now, whenever there's an issue, there's always the natural search for the guilty. Who's wrong? Who did it? And that's not really the answer. That's everybody's gut reaction. But the issue doesn't lie at the feet of one person or one organization. We all own this issue. The easiest and most common thing for all of us to do is to look at Rugby Canada and say, you're the National Sport Federation, it's your fault. Go and fix it. It's very easy for Rugby Canada to say, well, our development system's not working, and who owns the development system? Our provinces and the clubs. That's not the right answer either. That's not the right approach. The right approach is for us all to recognize that we all own a piece of this. We all have to work together to find solutions. This is our collective challenge, and it's our collective responsibility to find new solutions to problems that have existed for years in Canadian rugby. We're facing a lot of the same discussions that we faced year over year, time and time again. But I do want to emphasize that it's not our responsibility, it's our collective responsibility. There is no one magic solution or one person who can change or fix what we need to fix. There isn't just one problem to fix. The only way forward is a collective approach founded on honest, frank, uncomfortable truths that we must commit to telling each other. We can't just say it's good or we need more here, we need more there. We need to be honest about what's going to work in each of our areas. We need to find solutions that will work, but we have to recognize that it's not going to be one solution to a problem that we find that works across our vast country. It's going to be a unique implementation of that solution in every province and potentially in every club that we collectively work with. And we must be open to finding those solutions in that fashion. So this weekend, I tasked our management team to be more frank and brutally honest than they've likely ever been before, particularly at an AGM. And I've challenged them to tell those uncomfortable truths that we must face together. In doing so, we purposely built in time at the end of every presentation, likely never enough time, in which to solicit feedback, to engage with you, and to hear questions. And my plea to you is to not sit on your hands. Be engaged, challenge, ask questions, throw out solutions. Let's talk. Let's use the time we have outside of the presentations to pick up on those conversations, on those presentations, to find solutions. In fact, this should be our opportunity for 2017 to be a turning point in Canadian rugby. In 2016, we launched our strategic plan. Nice, colorful document, a document that is our guidepost in terms of how we've said we're going to lead the organization over the course of the next 4 years. The plan was developed in consultation with Rugby Canada's management, our board, and you, the provincial unions. We didn't develop this in isolation. This is something we came together and developed, and it's that approach that we need to take moving forward. This plan has provided our framework and guideposts over the last 12 months. And I just want to reference in page 27, for those who are familiar with the document, kind of what it said, what our focus should be, and where we should be headed. So what's our focus? Despite the difficulty of predicting accurately the future and the added challenge of the uncertain economic climate, past and future, the longer-term direction for Rugby Canada must hinge around three major themes. One, a stable financial platform with a significantly higher level of self-generated funding than current. Two, a continued focus to ensure the as one, a community to country philosophy, the harnessing of partnerships and a strong domestic game. Three, a targeted approach to high performance programming coupled with clear international performance expectations. And where should we be headed? While this strategic plan focuses on the period of 2016 to 2019, it's imperative to contemplate the longer term. To prepare for the future of rugby in Canada, we must set our sights on long-term aspirations, including podium performances at Summer Olympic Games, legitimizing Canada's ability to host pinnacle world international events, including future Rugby World Cup tournaments, being a world leader in player welfare and safe sport programming, being a mainstay on the World Rugby Sevens Series, both men and women, leading performance standards in elite women's rugby, and a tier one nation for rugby in accordance with World Rugby rankings. Now that's what we said, what we should focus on and where we should be headed. And I challenge anyone today to say that we haven't been focused on that, and in fact, we haven't already ticked off some of those boxes. But as strategic plans are, they provide broad direction, and the details must, in fact, be developed, modified, and updated annually. We have some time at the end of Saturday to talk about the plan, to get your feedback and input in terms of how we modify the strategic plan and what our areas of focus are on moving forward. Successes and outcomes from that plan won't happen overnight. Our system has not produced the masses of players ready to progress to the elite level for a few years now. It will take years to see the fruits of the labor that come out of this weekend and out of this plan. One of the best things about rugby, as I've been a new entrant into the rugby community, is the passionate, if that's a strong enough word, and committed fan base that is rugby in Canada. And we've heard from some of them recently with their criticisms, and that's okay. We will assuredly hear from them again. This isn't an easy road to travel, but we must continue the journey as we did in 2016. And that journey is only successful if we travel it together. One of our stated objectives that we've discussed in the past is to bring professional rugby to Canada and North America. We spent a lot of time and effort over the last few months developing and nurturing our strategic alignment with USA Rugby around a Rugby World Cup bid and the importance of professional rugby to that long-term vision. The prospects of professional rugby coming to North America in the next 2 to 4 years is very real, and it's incredibly exciting. It's without a doubt a key ingredient to our success on the international stage, but it's not the magic elixir that will make everything good. It's just one part of it. Our real solutions start with our clubs and our provinces and the support that Rugby Canada can provide them. They start with committed, talented, inspirational coaches at the grassroots who motivate and excite youth to keep playing rugby. Our rookie rugby program is a huge focus for all of us in 2017, and it will be for many years to come. It's without a doubt a massive part of our collective future success. But again, it isn't the only answer. We won't really see the outcomes of rookie rugby until 2027 and beyond. We need to continue to grow rookie rugby, but we must also find ways to strengthen relationships with our clubs and schools where high school age kids can gain the critical rugby skills they need as they start to find their potential. We need them to be inspired and to aspire to wear our national team jersey and to play professional rugby in Canada. We must continue to broaden our pathway. As such, we need to work together to ensure our clubs and provincial teams are not overly focused on winning at the expense of developing great players and putting those players on national teams. That should be our hallmark of success. We're committed to working with you to find solutions collectively and independently within your provinces and within the clubs. Now, shifting focus specifically to 2017, I want to share a bit of information with you about our priorities for this year and about our budget in 2017. From a budgeting perspective, 2017 has been a challenging year and will be a challenging year. We've created a very realistic budget capturing all of our costs and revenues. We've seen an approximate $500,000 negative impact due to the exchange rate with the British pound and reductions in World Rugby funding. However, we've importantly increased player support for all of our national teams, senior teams. We've seen across the board increases in every department and program. That's just the cost of doing business. We've implemented new approaches to generate new revenues. They're aggressive but realistic targets. And all of it has forced us to tighten our belts, continually looking to find ways to increase efficiency. We have a higher percentage of dollars going to rugby activities than ever before. A few important statistics comparing our 2017 budget with 2016. We have a 39% increase in the budget for our National Senior Men's 15s program, an 88% increase in the budget for our National Senior Women's program as they go to compete for the World Cup in Ireland this August. We've talked about and shared with you the unfortunate OTP cuts that have come to our men's sevens program, but we've only seen a 15% reduction in that program's budget this calendar year, this fiscal year. So we've retained a focus on what needs to happen for that men's sevens program to be back into the OTP funding envelope. And overall, we've increased our high performance budget by 16% over 2016. We have a 27% increase in our rookie rugby budget, and commercial gross revenues are projected to increase by 12%, with an increase in net proceeds from our commercial operations of 88%. So we're generating more revenues, being more efficient, and putting more money towards rugby than ever before. In 2017, we've decided that we're going to focus on five core areas in addition to, obviously, the core parts of our business, but five undercurrents that will drive our activities this year. Number one, an emphasis on player welfare, engagement, and support. Engagement with our current national team players, and importantly, with our alumni. They're our best spokespeople, and they're the individuals in our community that we must inform and provide them with what we're doing and how we're doing it. Number two, a greater focus on strategic planning. Planning ahead in a strategic way versus managing day to day as things happen. This is a very busy sport and a very busy sport federation for everybody in this room, but we need to have our eye on the long-term objectives, not just what's happening day to day. Number three, communication, and you'll hear more about this tomorrow in a specific presentation about communications. But we have to tell the story of what Rugby Canada is doing, where we are looking to go, and how we're going to go about doing it. Stories about developing the game, growing participation, about our passionate community, and the great players that we have. We have to have increased communication with our players on what we do and how we do it. Increased communication between the internal departments at Rugby Canada, and increased communication with our provincial members and our community of supporters. Number four, we are going to collaborate unlike ever before. There's going to be collaboration between national teams, coaches working together. There's absolutely no silos in our national team programs. We're going to have increased collaboration between our three offices in Langford, Richmond Hill, and in Vancouver with our Canada 7 staff. And in fact, that collaboration between Rugby Canada and our Canada 7 staff and project is more important than ever. And most importantly, we're going to have increased collaboration between our provinces and our clubs. And our fifth area of focus is on commercialization. Taking the leap to the next phase on corporate partnership growth and activation and engagement. How do our corporate partners help tell our story together? Bringing rugby in Canada to the mainstream of sports, media, and awareness across the country. Mapping out the development of professional rugby in North America. Aligning with USA Rugby on commercial interests, professional rugby, all leading to a joint bid and hosting of a Men's Rugby World Cup in 2027 or 2031. And leveraging the Canada 7 tournaments, our Rugby World Cup qualifier, and crucially important, our women's participation in the Rugby World Cup as our pinnacle events this year. In closing, this is a critically important time for rugby in Canada. If you haven't picked up on our theme yet, we need to work together. Thank you, provinces, for sharing your questions and topics you want to hear about in advance of this meeting. I think we've covered the vast majority, if not all of them, in our presentations. And as always, we're open to hearing from you, and I encourage to hear from you throughout this weekend if you're not hearing what you want to hear about. But importantly, as I said, engage with us, ask us questions, challenge us, challenge each other. Thank you to the entire rugby community for sharing your passion and for the provinces and members for being with us this weekend. Let's make 2017 a year that we can look back on as the year that we really started to make a change in Canadian rugby. Thanks very much.